Good morning. Welcome to St. Catherine's Parish Church in Burbage. And what a momentous day it is for us to gather both in church, in person, and online. And we welcome everyone to our service today. Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, during Lent we have prepared by works of love and self-sacrifice for the celebration of the Lord's death and resurrection. Today we begin this solemn celebration in union with the Church throughout the world. Christ enters into his own city to complete his work as our Saviour, to suffer, to die, and to rise again. Let us go with him in faith and love, so that united with him in his sufferings, we may share his risen life. So at this moment in the service, I'd like you all to hold up your palm crosses at home and in church. Just going to purify our curate. God our Saviour, whose Son, Jesus Christ, entered Jerusalem as Messiah to suffer and to die, let these palms be a sign of his victory, and grant that we who bear them in his name may ever hail him as our King, and follow him in the way that leads to everlasting life, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. We now have our opening hymn, Ride On, Ride On in Majesty.
Hear the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark. Glory to you, O Lord.
The Passover and the Feast of Unleavened Bread were to take place in 2 days' time. So the chief priests and the scribes were seeking a way to arrest him by treachery and put him to death. They said,
"Not during the festival, for fear that there may be a riot among the people."
When he was in Bethany, reclining at a table in the house of Simon the leper, a woman came with an alabaster jar of perfumed oil, costly, genuine spikenard. She broke the alabaster jar and poured it on his head. There were some who were indignant.
"Why has there been this waste of perfumed oil? It could have been sold for more than 300 days' wages and the money given to the poor."
They were infuriated with her. Jesus said,
"Let her alone. Why do you make trouble for her? She has done a good thing for me. The poor you will always have with you, and whenever you wish, you can do good for them. But you will not always have me. She has done what she could. She has anticipated anointing my body for burial. Amen, I say to you, wherever the gospel is proclaimed to the whole world, what she has done will be told in memory of her."
Then Judas Iscariot, one of the 12, went off to the chief priests to hand him over to them. When they heard him, they were pleased and promised to pay him money. Then he looked for an opportunity to hand him over. On the first day of the Feast of Unleavened Bread, when they sacrificed the Passover lamb, his disciples said to him,
"Where do you want us to go and prepare for you to eat the Passover?"
He sent two of his disciples and said to them,
"Go into the city and a man will meet you carrying a jar of water. Follow him. Wherever he enters, say to the master of the house, 'The teacher says, where is my guest room where I may eat the Passover with my disciples?' Then he will show you a large upper room furnished and ready. Make the preparations for us there."
The disciples then went off, entered the city, and found it just as he had told them, and they prepared the Passover. When it was evening, he came with the 12, and as they reclined at table and were eating, Jesus said,
"Amen, I say to you, one of you will betray me, one who is eating with me."
They began to be distressed and say to him one by one,
"Surely it is not I."
He said to them,
"One of the 12, the one who dips with me into the dish, for the Son of Man indeed goes as it is written of him, but woe to that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would be better for that man if he had never been born."
While they were eating, he took bread, and blessing, broke it, and gave it to them, and said,
"Take it, this is my body."
Then he took a cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, and they all drank from it. He said to them,
"This is my blood of the covenant, which will be shed for many. Amen, I say to you, I shall not drink again the fruit of the vine until the day when I drink it new in the kingdom of God."
Then, after singing a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. Then Jesus said to them,
"All of you will have your faith shaken, for it is written, 'I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep will be dispersed.' But after I have been raised up, I shall go before you to Galilee."
Peter said to him,
"Even though all should have their faith shaken, mine will not be."
Then Jesus said to him,
"Amen, I say to you, this very night, before the cock crows twice, you will deny me three times."
But he vehemently replied,
"Even though I should have to die with you, I will not deny you."
And they all spoke similarly. Then they came to a place named Gethsemane, and he said to his disciples,
"Sit here while I pray."
He took with him Peter, James, and John, and began to be troubled and distressed. Then he said to them,
My soul is sorrowful even to death. Remain here and keep watch.
He advanced a little and fell to the ground and prayed that if it were possible, the hour might pass him by. He said,
Abba, Father, all things are possible to you. Take this cup away from me, but not what I will, but what you will.
When he returned, he found them asleep. He said to Peter,
Simon, are you asleep? Could you not keep watch for 1 hour? Watch and pray that you may not undergo the test. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak.
Withdrawing again, he prayed, saying the same thing. Then he returned once more and found them asleep, for they could not keep their eyes open and did not know what to answer him. He returned a third time and said to them,
Are you still sleeping and taking your rest? It is enough. The hour has come. Behold, the Son of Man is to be handed over to sinners. Get up, let us go. See, my betrayer is at hand.
Then, while he was speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived, accompanied by a crowd with swords and clubs, who had come from the chief priests, the scribes, and the elders. His betrayer had arranged a signal with them, saying,
The man I shall kiss is the one. Arrest him and lead him away securely.
He came and immediately went over to him and said,
Rabbi.
And he kissed him. At this, they laid hands on him and arrested him. One of the bystanders drew his sword, struck the high priest's servant, and cut off his ear. Jesus said to them in reply,
Have you come out as against a robber with swords and clubs to seize me? Day after day I was with you teaching in the temple area, yet you did not arrest me, but that the scriptures may be fulfilled.
And they all left him and fled. Now a young man followed him, wearing nothing but a linen cloth about his body. They seized him, but he left the cloth behind and ran off naked. They led Jesus away to the high priest, and all the chief priests and elders and the scribes came together. Peter followed him at a distance into the high priest's courtyard and was seated with the guards, warming himself at the fire. The chief priests and the entire Sanhedrin kept trying to obtain testimony against Jesus in order to put him to death, but they found none. Many gave false witness against him, but their testimony did not agree. Some took the stand and tested falsely against him, alleging,
We heard him say, I will destroy this temple made with hands, and within 3 days I will build another not made with hands.
Even so, their testimony did not agree. The high priest rose before the assembly and questioned Jesus, saying,
Have you no answer? What are these men testifying against you?
But he was silent and answered nothing. Again, the high priest asked him and said to him,
Are you the Christ, the Son of the Blessed One?
Then Jesus answered,
I am. And you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of the power and coming with the clouds of heaven.
At that, the high priest tore his garments and said,
What further need have we of witnesses? You have heard the blasphemy. What do you think?
They all condemned him as deserving to die. Some began to spit on him. They blindfolded him and struck him and said to him,
Prophesy.
And the guards greeted him with blows. While Peter was below in the courtyard, one of the high priest's maids came along. Seeing Peter warming himself, she looked intently at him and said,
You too were with the Nazarene, Jesus.
But he denied it, saying,
I neither know nor understand what you're talking about.
So he went out into the outer courtyard. Then the cock crowed. The maid saw him and began again to say to the bystanders,
This man is one of them.
Once again, he denied it. A little later, the bystanders said to Peter once more,
"Surely you are one of them, for you too are a Galilean."
He began to curse and swear,
"I do not know this man whom you're talking about."
And immediately a cock crowed a second time. Then Peter remembered the word that Jesus had said to him, "Before the cock crows twice, you will deny me three times." He broke down and wept. As soon as morning came, the chief priests with the elders and the scribes, that is the whole Sanhedrin, held a council. They bound Jesus, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate. Pilate questioned him,
"Are you the king of the Jews?"
He said to him in reply,
"You say so."
The chief priests accused him of many things. Again, Pilate questioned him,
"Have you no answer? See how many things they accuse you of."
Jesus gave him no further answer, so that Pilate was amazed. Now, on the occasion of the feast, he used to release to them one prisoner whom they requested. A man called Barabbas was then in prison, along with the rebels who had committed murder and rebellion. The crowd came forward and began to ask him to do for them as he was accustomed. Pilate answered,
"Do you want me to release to you the king of the Jews?"
For he knew that it was out of envy that the chief priests had handed him over. But the chief priests stirred up the crowd to have him release Barabbas for them instead. Pilate again said to them in reply,
"Then what do you want me to do with this man you call the king of the Jews?"
They shouted again,
"Crucify him."
Pilate said to them,
"Why? What evil has he done?"
They only shouted the louder,
"Crucify him."
So Pilate, wishing to satisfy the crowd, released Barabbas to them, and after he had had Jesus scourged, handed him over to be crucified. The soldiers led him away inside the palace, that is the praetorium, and assembled the whole cohort. They clothed him in purple, and weaving a crown of thorns, placed it on him. They began to salute him with,
"Hail, King of the Jews!"
and kept striking his head with a reed and spitting upon him. They knelt before him in homage, and when they had mocked him, they stripped him of the purple cloak, dressed him in his own clothes, and led him out to crucify him. They pressed into service a passerby, Simon, a Cyrenian, who was coming in from the country, the father of Alexander and Rufus, to carry his cross. They brought him to the place of Golgotha, which is translated place of the skull. They gave him wine drugged with myrrh, but he did not take it. Then they crucified him and divided his garments by casting lots to see what each should take. It was 9 o'clock in the morning when they crucified him. The inscription of the charge against him read, "The King of the Jews." With him they crucified two revolutionaries, one on his right and one on his left. Those passing by reviled him, shaking their heads and saying,
"Aha, you who would destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days, save yourself by coming down from the cross."
Likewise, the chief priests with the scribes mocked him among themselves and said,
"He saved others, he cannot save himself. Let the Christ, the King of Israel, come down now from the cross, that we may see and believe."
Those who were crucified with him also kept abusing him. At noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 in the afternoon. And at 3 o'clock, Jesus cried out in a loud voice,
"Eloi, Eloi, lema sabachthani,"
which is translated,
my God, why have you forsaken me?"
Some of the bystanders who heard it said,
"Look, He is calling Elijah.
One of them ran, soaked a sponge with wine, put it on a reed, and gave it to him to drink, saying,
"Wait, let's see if Elijah comes to take him down."
Jesus gave a loud cry and breathed his last. The veil of the sanctuary was torn in two from top to bottom. When the centurion who stood facing him saw how he breathed his last, he said,
"Truly, this man was the Son of God."
This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Just try to imagine that day, the culmination of the ministry of Jesus, the crowds pressing in on all sides, shouting, "Hosanna, Hosanna to the Son of David. Glory, glory to the King of Kings." As we've heard that rendition of the Passion narrative, traditionally we remember all that was foretold and was to happen in the days to come. Was it the beginning of the end? Or just the end of the beginning? For those of us who have encountered Jesus, it is the beginning of a new story of Jesus coming into our lives and changing who we are, rewriting our DNA, as it were. It is surely the end of Jesus' earthly ministry. So this week, as we begin our Holy Week pilgrimage to that place of Golgotha, and then on Easter Day, of that place of resurrection, let us offer ourselves once more into God's hand. We give thanks to God today that we're able to gather in person and online. Let us not just forget this day, remember this story, and let it have its own imprint on your life this week. In these moments, let us just be quiet, and then I will say the collect of the day. Let us pray for a closer union with Christ in his suffering and in his glory. True and humble King, hailed by the crowd as Messiah, grant us faith to know you and love you, that we may be found beside you on the way of the cross. which is the path of glory. Amen.
Let us pray. We stand with Christ in his suffering. For forgiveness for the many times we have denied Jesus, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For grace to seek out those habits of sin, which means spiritual death, and by prayer and self-discipline to overcome them, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For Christian people, that through the suffering of disunity they may grow rich union in Christ, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those who make laws, interpret them, and administer them, that our common life may be ordered in justice and mercy, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy. For those who have the courage and honesty to work openly for justice and peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those in the darkness and agony of isolation, that they may find support and encouragement, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those weighed down with hardship, failure, or sorrow, feel that God is far away from them, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those who are tempted to give up the way of the cross, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
That we, with those who have died in faith, may find mercy in the day of Christ, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Holy God, holy and strong, holy and immortal, have mercy upon us.
Once we were far off, but now in union with Christ Jesus, we have been brought near through the shedding of Christ's blood, for he is our peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Let us offer one another a sign of peace.
Be with you.
Peace be with you.
Peace be with you.
Peace to everyone.
Peace with you all. Peace,
everybody.
Peace with you all.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness we have this bread to offer, which earth has given and human hands have made. It will become for us the bread of life.
Blessed be God forever.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness, we have this wine to offer, fruit of the vine and work of human hands. It will become for us our spiritual drink.
Blessed be God forever.
The Lord be with you. Give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is indeed right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Jesus Christ our Lord. For at this time of his passion and resurrection draws near, the whole world is called to acknowledge his hidden majesty. The power of the life-giving cross reveals the judgment that has come upon the world, and the triumph of Christ crucified. He is the victim who dies no more, the Lamb once slain, who lives forever, our advocate in heaven, to plead our cause, exalting us there to join with angels and archangels, forever praising you and saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he that comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Lord, you are holy indeed, the source of all holiness. Grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit and according to your holy will, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. When the same night that he was betrayed, he took bread, gave you thanks, broke it, gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Jesus Christ is Lord. Lord, by your cross and resurrection, you have set us free. You are the Saviour of the world. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup. He gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. Jesus Christ is Lord. Lord, by your cross and resurrection, you have set us free. You are the Saviour of the world. And so, Father, calling to mind his death on the cross, his perfect sacrifice made once for the sins of the whole world, rejoicing in his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming in glory, we celebrate this memorial of our redemption. As we offer you this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, we bring before you this bread and this cup, and we thank you for counting us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. Send the Holy Spirit upon your people and gather into one into your kingdom all who share this one bread and this one cup, so that we, in the company of the Blessed Virgin Mary, St. Catherine, St. Peter, and all the saints, may praise and glorify you forever through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory be yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Let us pray with confidence as our Saviour has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Every time we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again. Jesus is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Blessed are those who are called to his supper.
Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed.
Say together the prayer of communion in separation. Lord Jesus Christ, life giver and good physician, here you meet me in our need. In a world marred by corruption and marked by death, draw me into true life. By your selfless sacrifice, help me to live for others and not myself. May I, who cannot now receive you sacramentally, embrace you more fully in my heart, mind, and soul. Help me unite myself to you in spirit, so that I may be drawn closer to those from whom I'm isolated in the body. Through sharing your life, giving up in death for us all, may we grow together in love into a richer and more profound communion of life. Amen. So before our final blessing and final hymn, we're just going to do a little couple act. I've just announced to Ross that we'll do. So it should be fun. We're just going to try and do the notices. I haven't got a notice sheet, and I don't know if you have. So we're trying to remember the notice sheet that we have read. First and foremost, thank you to all that came and enjoyed themselves at the St. Patrick's Night. So far, I think that's raised £410 for the church. So that's a great effort. Well done. And on the back of that, we're now going to have the long promised awaited afternoon tea for those that have prepaid. Your money is still safe under the settee. That's fine. But that's on St. George's Day. And there's a little extra, if you'd like to pay a little extra, we've got some little bottles of Prosecco. So I thought it might be nice to crack open a little bit of bubbly. So details are on the note sheet. I hope I have whetted your appetite with that little thing. It's been great to get together and maintain that community aspect of the church. And what a surprise that we had last time with Gordon the Gopher singing the Athen Rye song. I thought that was wonderful, that little puppet. It was for a never to be forgotten event. So thank you to that lady that sung that. It was Gordon the Gopher, wasn't it? Was it? No? Yes, it was. Was it the original? It might have been. Excellent. Right. So I want Ross to explain a little bit about Holy Week and the vigil, if you will.
Okay, so on Maundy Thursday, we are going to be keeping a vigil after the service from about 8:30 until midnight. So you're very welcome to come for as long a time or as short a time as you like. There will be some prayer resources provided, but it would be great if we could have some people sign up for half-hour slots, just so we know that there will be someone in church. So if you are able to help with that, please do let me know and I can put a rota together.
Thank you very much. Yeah, so there's a communion each night at 7:30 and we're either on Facebook Live or on Zoom. Good Friday morning is at 10 o'clock. I know we really should be in the afternoon, but we decided to try and stick to everything at 10 o'clock. I do hope that we can experience Holy Week in some shape or form together. But also there's that aspect of being alone as well, isn't there? And experience something of Jesus being alone as well during this most holiest of weeks. So please do read the notice sheet. If Easter lilies and names are still being collected in, so if you haven't yet sent out any names or donations, please continue to do. It's okay to do it right up until the very end, literally, before we actually say the names. I know Martin and Christy don't be fretting now, but never mind. Never mind. Are there any other notices? Have I noticed you all out now? It's been lovely to see you all today, and I could ramble on forever.
Join us for a service tonight on Facebook Live. Yes.
Join us for a service tonight on Facebook Live for Evensong on Palm Sunday, which usually would have been down at Aston, wouldn't it? Aston Flamwell will be open next Sunday morning for Easter service as well as us. So please continue to look at the notice sheet for all the times of the services. And just a little foretaste, in May, we have agreed as the PCC to, if the restrictions allow, to go back to 8 o'clock, 10:30 and 6 p.m. So it's only for April that we're doing these times of 10 o'clock in the Sunday morning. As from May, we'll be going back to the olden days, if we can. Okay? Thank you very much. Right, please can we stand for the blessing then? Christ crucified, draw you to himself, to find in him a sure ground for faith, a firm support for hope, and the assurance of sins forgiven. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Could I ask you to leave as soon as you can? If you want to chat, please do chat outside. Maintain social distance, hands, face, and space. And we're now going to sing our final hymn, Praise to the Holiest in the Height.
Keep safe.
Bye, everyone.
Bye. Bye, everybody. Bye.